Hello everyone, thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak at this consumer conference. Today I'll touch upon a few issues concerning the role of consumers in shaping harm reduction policies, the barriers in the way, and what can be done to overcome them. I'm a consumer advocate from India, where we are fighting against a ban on safer alternatives. I'm also the president of International Network of Nicotine Consumer Organizations, or INCO, which is an umbrella body of national organizations from over 35 nations. Collectively, we are working towards ensuring that consumers have a say in making policies which affect them in critical ways. Tobacco use is a global concern, but nowhere is the situation more acute than in Asia Pacific. Of the 1.1 billion tobacco users globally, most of whom are smokers, over 60% live in this region. Asia Pacific also has the highest rates of smoking, hovering around 45% among males. At present, the Southeast Asian region has the highest number of tobacco users in the world, but the Western Pacific region is slated to overtake it in the coming years. Also, as you can see, while there is a projected reduction in users, and this is WHO's own projection, this rate of decline is so slow it will be decades before we are anywhere near achieving the fantastical goal of tobacco use elimination, during which time over 1 billion people will die. While these figures and projections alone should have made the WHO realize that the current approaches are not working, not only is the tobacco control machinery doubling down on its failing measures, it also continues to deny over 1 billion people any say in the matter. What began as a war against the tobacco industry has turned into a war against smokers, with prohibitionism and punitive measures becoming the centerpiece of tobacco control strategies. For WHO, tobacco users are misguided people who cannot decide for themselves and need to be beaten into submission through bans, social stigma, and increasing taxes. In the next few slides, I would like to show you how much this ideology is in conflict with other United Nations policies. Consumers are considered key to decision making, and there are UN guidelines which cement their role and outline ways to preserve and amplify their voice. In 1985, the UN General Assembly adopted guidelines for consumer protection, which laid emphasis on the development of independent consumer voices, which can guide policy making, and on giving consumers more choice at better price points by framing regulations accordingly. They also spoke about protection for vulnerable and disadvantaged groups, which smokers increasingly are, as they suffer grave consequences, and a majority of them are from the lower economic strata. Then there is the focus on helping consumers make informed choices by ensuring they have accurate information about risks. And we know where that is going in tobacco control with the massive misinformation campaigns launched in recent years against safer alternatives, some coming from the WHO itself. If there was even a little appreciation of these UN guidelines, we would have seen a significantly different approach to tobacco control. Even in UN drug policies, and many illicit drug users can be said to have far less agency over their habit than those who consume tobacco, there is strong appreciation of the right of individuals and an understanding that punitive action can go against human rights. And also that the achievable goal is not to eliminate tobacco use, but to manage it. The UNDP, or the United Nations Development Programme, released a set of guidelines on human rights and drug policy last year. They lay out a humanitarian approach to drugs control, stating that punishing and isolating users is ineffective in modifying behavior and leads to more problems than it solves. A human rights approach which acknowledges that users are human beings first, with varied needs and motivations, is infinitely more effective. There's also a clear focus on harm reduction, which has somehow become an evil term in tobacco control. It is saddening and infuriating that tobacco control is refusing to learn any lessons from the failed drug wars, repeating the same mistakes at the cost of millions of lives. The International Tobacco Policy, WHO's Framework Convention for Tobacco Control, or the FCTC, began on the right note when the treaty was adopted in 2003 by over 180 nations. It laid out an emphasis, like the other UN treaties, on the role of consumers and consumer groups in helping shape and implement its goals. Further, in the introductory Article 1 itself, the role of harm reduction strategies in reducing tobacco-related mortality and morbidity was acknowledged. But things went downhill from there as FCTC lost sight of its goal to reduce tobacco deaths and disease, and got caught up in a moral war against tobacco use. It has been over 15 years since, and yet the number of tobacco users globally has remained the same. So what went wrong? Quite a few things in my view. Firstly, the focus became battling the well-heeled tobacco industry. The humanitarian view was lost, and the mounting tobacco deaths became a statistic to fight the industry rather than something that needed to be addressed with urgency. This is evident from the implementation of the Empower program, which focuses almost entirely on demand reduction, and of which offering help to consumers remains the least implemented measure to this day, with only 23 nations offering meaningful quit support to smokers. Worse, consumers became collateral damage in this war, as the efforts to isolate the industry have translated into exclusion of consumers. The biennial meetings of FCTC are now secret affairs which no tobacco users or layperson can attend. We consumers from over 15 nations were thrown out after the plenary session at the last meeting held in Geneva in 2018. We were left to protest outside the venue while policies which affect us were being made in private and without any accountability. The tobacco industry was, however, still inside through the immense financial power it wields, but the consumers were not. Here I would like to point out FCTC's twisted view of the tobacco industry. Its Article 5.3 bars any interaction with the industry, but curiously, the FCTC does not prohibit the nations themselves from participating in tobacco trade. So we have countries like India, like Thailand, Vietnam, China and others who are tobacco traders themselves and yet get to decide global tobacco policies, while consumers are denied a seat at the table citing this Article 5.3. Further, though harm reduction is part of FCTC's framing document, it is viciously denied in practice. As if while technology has improved every other sphere of our lives, it is somehow impossible to make smoking less harmful. Despite harm reduction strategies proving beneficial in drugs policy approaches, despite also that within a short span of time, 70 million smokers have already switched to safer alternatives, and despite overwhelming scientific evidence, the WHO and the FCTC and various governments continue to deny it works. The problem, I think, also lies in FCTC's timeline. It was adopted in 2003 when, barring snus, there were no safer alternatives on the market.
Is first a decision to ban e-cigarettes.
But the landscape has altered since, and now significant risk reduction is possible. Yet what we are seeing is tobacco control's stubborn refusal to adapt to this new reality. This is evident in the opening of another prohibitionist front by pushing vape bans. Where drug prohibition failed and caused severe human rights violations, which forced a serious rethink, we now have escalated efforts to infringe upon the rights of over a billion people who could better their lives by substituting use of harmful tobacco products. The most important cog in this hijacking of priorities are private funders, whose authority comes not from the people, but from the financing of the tobacco control machinery. Most of the tobacco-related reports published last year by the WHO were funded by Bloomberg Philanthropies, which also funds massive misinformation campaigns against safer alternatives across nations. The tobacco control narrative is now controlled not by people's representatives who ought to be looking out for them, but by a few rich donors who have decided to shape the world according to their views. And how distorted their views are became apparent when one Bloomberg-funded organization, the Union, recently proposed that developing nations should ban risk-reduced products. There's a lot to be said on how wrong this idea is, and at INCO we are working on a detailed rebuttal, but I would like to highlight this position for its highly discriminatory, patronizing outlook. I do not think anyone in any other field would dare propose such a policy that seeks to cement discrimination and increase health inequalities in the world. But in tobacco control, it's apparently acceptable to make such arguments. Never even mind that most of the 8 million a year tobacco deaths are in developing nations, where users have less access to healthcare and thus risk reduction could save the most lives. Which brings me to the last part of my talk. What can consumers do to push back against this denial of their rights and curbing of their freedoms? Here are a few suggestions. What we have going for us is that we are a significant population. which pays amongst the highest taxes on any product, which votes, and if we speak up together, our voice travels far.
We all need to raise our voices. We need to come together and share our stories on World Vape Day.
This was evident from the recent World Vape Day, when vapers around the world took to Twitter and held events to counter the WHO narrative against safer alternatives on the World No Tobacco Day, which was held the day after. The result was that vapers' tweets outnumbered those from tobacco control groups by a few times over. Another takeaway is that social media is a great leveler and gives people the platform to be heard. We can individually and collectively harness its potential by creating online groups and also by reaching out to those making decisions about us, whether they are from the tobacco control or the government. Using social media effectively and in a focused manner can do wonders. Becoming part of a movement, at a national or international levels, can help make our voices stronger and efforts more organized. I would request that you offer help to your national consumer organizations, and this need not be financial assistance, but to pool in expertise and resources, from helping organize activities to spreading the word. It is remarkable what a few dedicated people can achieve with support from the wider population. If your country does not have a consumer organization, feel free to reach out to us. We can help you organize. An informed consumer is tough to ignore. And for this, we ought to stay aware of the advances in science around safer alternatives. Our opposition is best heard when there is evidence-based and relies on facts to counter misinformation. There are a lot of resources, from newsletters and websites to YouTube channels and Twitter feeds, to stay updated about the latest developments. Finally, we should all feel collectively responsible for how vaping and the use of safer alternatives is perceived by people around us. A lot of public goodwill can be earned if we act responsibly and share testimonies of our struggles with quitting, and how safer alternatives have made a positive change in our lives. Thank you. I'll be happy to take questions in the live Q&A that follows.